29 to 15 or so.
Supposed to leave those doors closed. Those doors?
Yep.
They're supposed to be closed, aren't they? Somebody's slapping.
Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea you led your people Israel from slavery and into freedom. At the river your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word you claim us as your daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise and servants of all. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life, and above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit. Renew our lives with your forgiveness, your grace, and your love. To you, O Lord, be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Spirit, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
And as is appropriate after baptism, to share the peace that comes with us as being baptized Christians. And so I say to you, the peace of the Lord be with you always. ever-living God, increase in us the gifts of faith, of hope, and of love. And that we may obtain what you promised, make us love what you have commanded us, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The first reading for today is from the book of Jeremiah, the first chapter. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "Ah, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say, 'I am only a boy,' for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you," says the Lord. Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, "Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up, to pull down, to destroy, to overthrow, to build, and to plant." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So as to remove mountains, but do not have blood, I am If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror, dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part. Then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, and the greatest of these is love. The Lord, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Difficult, just can't do it. Well, you gotta think about it because because it's part of what the gospel's all about. So, I mean, I know we talked about it last week, but I just can't do it. I mean, I can't let that alligator here in my church. Well, you know, God calls all of his children. God loves all his children. I mean, we usually sing that. We didn't sing that this morning, but we didn't sing that. And God loves all his children, and the alligator is one of his children, and you got to let him in church. Yeah, but what if we let all the alligators in church, and then I'll be up to my front paws and alligators. Feet. Yeah, well, you know, that's kind of, I want to let you know, that's kind of what I said when you first joined, you know, the church way back when, and that is, it was fine for the church mice. Everybody's heard of church mouse, but nobody's heard of church frogs. Are you kidding me? Yeah, that's the way I felt. But you know what? Then I read the gospel and I learned that, you know, God's love is for all of us. The greatest of these gifts is love. And that's what Paul writes in the second lesson today. So, I have to love him, but I can't love him at a distance. Well, maybe when you're in the lake and there and it's lunchtime, you can love him at a distance. But here in church, you let him in church. Because it's not your church. You said my church, but it's not your church. What do you mean, it's my church? No, it's not. It's where you belong. It's the church of Jesus Christ. That's God's church. It's our Lord's church. And so he gives us our marching orders. He tells us what he wants from us. And he's commanded us that we love others. How can you command to love somebody? You command to love somebody through your actions. You act like you love them. You know what? Pretty soon you will, because you get to know them just like I love you. We've been together all these years. Yeah, I guess we have. We have been together a long time. Yes, we have. We've proclaimed God's word for a long time. Yeah, that's God's word of love. Yeah, I guess I'm just being a little bit fearful. I guess you are. Can't let that stand in the way of God's love, because God won't hear it. This is God's church, and those doors are open for anyone. All are welcome. All. Everyone. Even the alligators. Even the alligators. Wow. All right. I agree with you. I guess I'll just have to overcome whatever fear I have and go, okay, it's time that we love our neighbors but as ourselves, right? That's exactly right. I think I got it. I'll work at it really hard. All right? Allie, you can come into church.
Why do that to begin with? Because it's the church of Jesus Christ. It's not your church.
Oh, no, you're right. It's not my church. Okay, I don't make the rules. God does. Okay, I get it. All right, again, I'm ready. I'll try. That's all we can ask, is try to love our neighbors. Hey, you know what? We'll see you next week. Love, that's the greatest gift of all. This is not written for them, it's written for the other audience. the other audience was written for the congregation that Lou served, either as a pastor or organizer or whatever. And the rest of us is written for us, because it was written long after Jesus. So there's messages here for us. So we've got to go back to last week, though. So basically, it was hometown boy, as we've seen in the newspaper. Hometown boy makes it big. Jesus is famous. At least he's been to Capernaum, according to today's lesson, before he came here to his hometown in Nazareth. He must have done some wonderful things there, because they were excited about this hometown boy. He's ours. You know, you can just see him. He's ours. And so he comes and teaches in the synagogue, and they go, isn't he great? He's preaching the year of the Lord's favor. That was an important phrase in Judaism of the time of the first century. The year of the Lord's favor meant that the time for celebrating has come, because God is about to do something, a final act, and bring us out of our oppression and free us from the Romans and get rid of the temple authority. God's going to act, and Jesus has just proclaimed that. He's the prophet. He also quotes Isaiah 61. The prisoners are going to be set free. The blind are going to see. Good news is going to be proclaimed to the poor. What else can you ask for? The people are having, hey, isn't this, there's two ways you can read this. If they go, isn't this Joseph's son? I mean, he's claiming to be somebody big. But I don't think it's to be taken that way. Isn't this Joseph's son? One of ours made it to the big time. He's a prophet. And we haven't had a prophet in a long time. John the Baptist, there was a big gap in Jewish history between the prophets and John the Baptist, who was kind of a prophet in the old sense. Jesus is something new. However, they're really excited. He's our Messiah. And they want him, and Jesus, he senses it, or they've said it to him, do some of the wonders here in your hometown for us that you did for the people of Capernaum. I mean, we expect better from you. You're one of us. As a matter of fact, the hometowns in those days were pretty much the extended family. The little villages were all one family. So it's family members. And I know that kind of well, because I can't tell you how many family members I've done weddings for. We're getting married, Uncle John. You'll be doing the wedding. Oh, I will. Okay. Yeah, that's what they expect, right? expecting to do my bidding, because after all, we own him. He's ours. Do for us, do for your family, what you did for them in Capernaum. Well, Jesus says something that really outrages him, so let's look at that for a minute. He talks about Elijah and Elisha. Now, one thing Luke wants his people to know, which we've kind of lost, but he wants the people to know in his congregation is that Jesus is going to follow Elijah and Elisha, which means both of them were kind of outside the temple for authorities. They both were kind of loose cannons, so to speak. They didn't proclaim the party line. They were a little bit rebellious. And so Luke wants people right up front to know Jesus isn't cut from the same cloth. So don't expect in this gospel the same old party line. And don't expect that he's going to be my Messiah or my Jesus. So, first thing Jesus says is, well, you know, back in the days, we learned from Scripture that the prophet Elijah was called and he came to the widow of Zarephath. What's the big deal? The big deal is she was a Gentile, not a Jew. She was the only one that was fed. She was the only one that God worked God's grace upon at that time. And then to make things worse, Jesus says, and you know Elisha, the prophet, there were a lot of people with leprosy at the time, but the one he healed was not one Assyrian, not a Jew, a Gentile. Now we understand why the people of the synagogue were outraged, his family was outraged. What are you telling us? I'm telling you, God's word is for everybody, is Jesus' act. They didn't want to hear it. Not in my synagogue, not in my church. You're not my Messiah. My granddaughter, my youngest granddaughter, was about 3 years old, and she met some of my oldest daughter's children, a little older than she, She met them for the first time on Thanksgiving at my sister's house. She came to me and said, Grandpa, what? Why is that girl calling you Grandpa? I said, because I'm her grandfather. No, you are not. You're my grandfather. Well, I have enough fathers and grandpa to go around. I have others, too. I have two others, which she did know. The other, my son's two children. Well, she said, if she, you're going to be her grandpa, then you're not my grandpa. So we have to get over that. Now when I talk about it, she watches, and she's 16 now, this week. But she was about 3 then. But that's the way sometimes it goes. You're my pastor, you're my, this is my church, I want it to go the way I want it to go. I expect that. And Jesus, right out of the gate, says, I'm not going to, first of all, I'm not going to do command performances for you. I'm not going to do what I did at Capernaum. We don't know what he did, because it's about us, but it must have been good. And what I have to proclaim, my role here in fulfilling the wishes of the Old Testament, that is the prophets, the prophet Isaiah, to bring good news and so on, is not just for you. It's for all, even the Gentile world. Well, then, as another person said to me one time, we're talking about forgiveness. We were driving home from the cemetery, the National Cemetery, Gainesville. I was riding with the director. Somehow we got talking about forgiveness. And he said, well, you know, not everybody can be forgiven. What would be the point? You know, the word of God can't be for everyone. It's for us. We want it to be for us. And that's you know, that's something that we all run into. We do want to be exclusive, even though we mouth the words inclusive. We want Jesus to be ours. And so we come up with ways like a litmus test. You accepted Jesus as your personal Savior. He's my personal Savior. I have him right here in my pocket. That's the way we talk. Like, we possess and we make God and Jesus and the It's God who is the subject, not you. And so they get outraged, and they take him out, and they're going to get rid of him. They're going to throw him off the cliff. A little dramatic story here for Luke. And so what does he do? He passes through the midst of them, unharmed. A little message that Luke has in his writing here, because he's writing after the events. It's a little message to the church that reflecting the resurrection. But a statement meaning they're not going to be able to quash the word of God. And they'll never be able to capture God, as Luther used to say, and put him in a box. Because you can't put God in a box. God will not be owned by anyone. He is actually not my God. I am his child. The possession goes the other way. First. Then he can be my God. But he's much bigger, or she. God is much bigger than even my imagination can all take hold of. And he passed in the midst of them. God's word will not be quashed. Another way to say this, you can try to kill him, but you'll never put down God's word. And that's the story of the Easter resurrection. You can't entomb God's word. So what happens? Jesus dies and is raised. The word continues on. The Holy Spirit, in kind of the early churches, try crucifying that, if you will. You can't even grab hold of the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit who grabs us and creates faith in us and calls us to discipleship, calls us to be followers and proclaim the word, because it's God's word that Jesus obeyed that will never be quenched. Think about it. 51 years ago, most of us were lucky enough to live through, it was tough times, but to live through Martin Luther King, you know, a hero in the making. There were a lot of people that was accused of being a communist and others, but all kinds of fake news and stuff about it. And we can remember that. Maybe some of us didn't particularly like what's going on. This is my country. You get that too. My country. I want it to be my way. I want it to reflect my desires and needs and wants. It's natural we do that, but we're called to be both of them. So Martin Luther King proclaimed the vision of peoples, of inclusivity, of people being together. You know, in that great speech, when a white boy and a white girl, or the other way around, can walk down the street hand in hand. So he had this great vision of that he placed out there before the world, before the country. We seem to be so far from that vision, and sometimes it seems that we're even further now away from using it. But not to be pessimistic. Much happened there. But what happened? Some decided that the best way to quash this whole thing is to get rid of it, to silence it. And he knew they were trying it. And somehow I'll relay a story that he wrote about when he was fearful of being killed, had to make a decision, do I stay in this thing or do I get out and go back to private life? And so let's look at what happened. Martin Luther King still lives, bigger than ever, more universal than ever, in a way that he can never be silenced. And that's how we determine what God's word is. Whether it's God's word or my word or your word, and that is, it can't be put out. It continues on. So in a very real way, Martin Luther King passed through the midst of that. The word continues, his vision continues, and it's alive. God's words will not be placed in a box, it won't be molded and worked by you or me. It doesn't matter that it's not my church, it's the church of Jesus Christ. And once we begin, you and I begin to realize the gifts of that, the grace of that, that God gives us, our hearts can be opened. Our minds can be changed. Say, what would you have us do? What is our mission? Because that's all we're here for. We're not here. confess our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
United as one body in Christ, let us pray for the Church, the world, and all those who are in need.
We pray for the Church. Inspire us by your Spirit as we respond to your call. When we are reluctant, strengthen us. When we are doubtful, encourage us. Above all, let your love shine through us. Gather us into a community guided by your love. Inspire in us a spirit of hospitality and kindness. Teach us to bear one another's burdens with compassion. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the earth, for the mountains and prairies, cities and farms, rainforests and deserts, awaken us to the mystery and diversity of your creation. Nurture all living things and protect your creation from harm. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For those in need, protect those who suffer abuse and encourage those who lack hope. Guide all who provide mental care. Comfort those who grieve and bring healing to the sick, especially Tony Dunell, Herb Shavering, Dave Coyle, the friends and family of Grace Lang, those on our prayer list, and those we offer now, either silently or aloud. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Receive our prayers and fill us with the radiance of your love through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending.
Thank you.
pray that in your mercy, you would strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And now bow down your hearts and receive the Lord's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you.